All right. Looks like we are now live as they get. Good afternoon. Hope y'all are all doing well. Welcome to week four of our spring seclusion series, Cocktails and Conservation. Let me show you. It is serious cocktails conservation time today. Thank you for your support. Thanks for being here every week. We appreciate you just taking part of this conversation today. It's going to be live, no doubt. And we're going to have a little fun as always. I appreciate you joining us. Hope all of our family flock out there has been in very good health during this pandemic. I know it's been crazy times. The turkey hunt's been maybe a little strange this year, but as long as we're still practicing that responsible recreation, I think we're all going to be good. We'll just leave it at that. So keep on keeping on for those of you that are lucky enough to keep turkey hunting. Here in Kentucky, it ended this past weekend, and unfortunately, I'm done. And many of you out there in the Southeast are done. But man, the folks up in the upper Midwest and out West, they're still hammering. Northeast, so good luck to everyone out there. Y'all, you guys be careful out in the field and have some fun. So, a little bit today about who I am again. My name is Jason Lapartis. I serve as our NWTF Director of Conservation Operations here in the Midwest. I have our two wild turkey experts here, the one and the only Dr. Michael Chamberlain and Dr. Bret Collier. Glad to have y'all again. They have a much better understanding of nesting and brooding than anyone out there. We may add a little bit to it as we go along. So we're going to work through some of this, talk a little bit about poult production, recruitment, just basic wild turkey population dynamics. That's a big mouthful, but we're going to hit on all that. All right, some more housekeeping before we really kick this thing off today. Behind the scenes, once again, we have Mark Hatfield, our National Director of Conservation Services, and Pete
Thanks,
Muller,
Evan.
our Public Relations Manager. Man, I love it. I love
Ooh.
that. Appreciate the dittos there.
I
Glad
want
to have y'all on.
to Sorry about the yelling for
I'm going to
everyone.
classify Brad and Mike as are kind of like our boss toms, right? I mean, they know what they're doing, and hopefully they're going to strut a little bit and give us a little bit of a work magic today. All right. So for all of you out there, man, send us some comments, ask us some questions, and I'm asking right now, let me lay the foundation. I want hard questions today. Nothing easy. I want them complicated, detailed. Make these guys think, okay? And I'm just going to have fun asking the questions. So no pressure on me. Sorry, Mike, Brett, but we're going to have some fun with this. All right, one more thing to hit on. We have what I would call as a few professionals out there in the ranks, and I want to list some names for you. Mr. Cully McCurdy out of West Virginia, Annie Farrell out of Texas, and Ricky Lackey out of Florida. Now, they are some of our NWTF conservation staff, aka professional wildlife biologists. These folks know their trade better than most anyone out there. And if you have questions, et cetera, we're going to ask you to kind of reach out and connect with these folks.
Ooh.
These people here, they're basically professionals that work multiple states. We're working closely with folks like Mike and Brett and other folks in the research arena across the United States to provide the best information for habitat management and really managing habitat and doing great conservation work across North America. So please note, if anyone has questions or want to find out maybe in your state who that professional is and how you can connect, I want you to go to our website. Pete, throw our website up, nwtf.org. If you punch in nwtf.org on any search engine, it'll pop up. We have a search button on our page. Just click on it, click on the name of the state you're in, and boom, you got everything you need. It is that easy. And you can get any information you need about folks to contact, folks that are in the volunteer ranks, people that represent us on our local state boards in each state. So this is a critical place to go. You can get a ton of information. So think about that if you need anything. All right. Got all the hard work out of the way. Let me take a quick sip here. We're back to cocktail time. I hope everyone else has one. Tonight, I mean, I got to share every night when I'm drinking, right? Because this is important. This one is just on the rocks. I just felt like I needed just plain, just beautiful brown bourbon to enjoy. So that's what we're doing tonight. Brown, plain bourbon. Come on. That's all we got. On the ice. Can you beat that? Not at all. All right. So, gentlemen, are you guys ready?
Yep.
I see head nods. First question. Now this might be a question you're not ready for, but would you agree that a happy wife equals a happy life? Oh, come on, boys. Come on now.
My wife will not watch this, so I'm gonna just defer to Mike on this one because he's my hero too.
I can say anything I want because my wife will never see this. She is so sick of hearing about turkeys. And she's told me recently that she's learned more about sperm storage and mating systems. And she's like, I am so sick about turkeys. She's actually banned me from discussing turkeys. When we walk together, she's like, if you say anything about turkeys, it's over. We're like, walk's done. So I would say, does it matter? I mean, in my house, we just kind of go with the flow. And when somebody's not happy, we just try to do the best we can to help each other. And man, I don't know. Life is life.
Gentlemen, let me help you guys. Listen, first of all, yes, I am drinking some good bourbon tonight. That's the only way to go. But number two, let me help y'all. So happy wife is happy life, right? And let me preach this a little bit before we dive into the dirty details of nesting and brooding. But this falls in line with what we're discussing this evening, right? I mean, the whole point of this is to keep the hen happy. And when the hen is happy, guess what? Everybody else is happy. I know I have probably preached this to more landowners out there and partners talking to them about habitat of, if we keep our hens happy, you know, you're going to have a pretty good spring season when production's good and we have lots of birds out in the field. Just saying. So that's what we're going to go with tonight. Are y'all ready for that?
Jason, just hold on now. In the turkey world, all we're trying to do is keep the hen alive.
Alive.
Okay. All right.
It's a slippery slope, man.
I mean, is it a happy hen, one that's alive, though? I mean, come on. Yeah. Okay. Well, all right. We're good with that. I just want to make sure.
The alternative is a happy hen is one that may copulate with multiple males during the reproductive season. And that entirely doesn't assist in the happy husband part of this either.
Well, you know what? I got to be honest with you, boys. I don't care about the husbands at all. I'm done. Let's scoop that one up, throw it out. We're talking about ladies tonight. All about the hens, right? All about the hens. All right, so this is what we're going to do. We're going to kick this discussion off and talk a little bit about wild turkey reproduction. I mean, y'all brought it up, right? So let's dive right on in. Let's talk a little bit about the reproduction. Tell us about the reproduction cycle. How many eggs does a typical hen have? I mean, just how does it work? Give us some details here.
Okay, I'll do this one, Mike. Generally across the board, with turkeys, we're looking at clutch sizes that range anywhere from around 8 to 14. The average seems to be about 11. A lot of times, and folks have been posting a lot of this on social media where you see nests that'll have, you know, 18 or 22 eggs or something like that in it. And we'll typically ascribe those to multiple females laying in those nests, and we'll get to that later. But a typical female is going to have about 11 eggs. And it doesn't really matter what subspecies we're talking about. That seems to be pretty consistent across the board. Now, it usually takes somewhere between about 12 and 14 days for that female to get the 11 or so eggs into the nest bowl. And the reason for that is as the female is laying eggs, she tends to lay about one egg a day. And then they tend to get later in the afternoon or later in the day as she's going through her laying cycle. And then at some point, she'll skip a day. And that's basically a physiological response, so her body can kind of ramp back up again. because you got to calcify all the eggs, you know, and everything. So they kind of have to be sure they've got the right conditions. So normally it takes about 14 days, and it varies a little bit, you know, for a full clutch to get down. Then during the time this female is kind of laying eggs, she's not staying at the nest site. She's moving around in a fairly small area, but moving a lot. She's really moving actively. So she'll go through, she'll stop at the nest maybe for an hour, however long it takes, and then she'll kick off again. And she doesn't actually start spending time at the nest site until she basically lays the last egg and starts incubating. And then the incubation period in turkeys, kind of the rule of thumb is about 28 days. It can be shorter than that. We've had some hatch off at about 25. It can be longer. We've had some go out to about 31. And these are ones where, you know, the eggs actually hatch. But across the board, they spend about 28 days sitting on the nest. And just to, so people understand what we're talking about, you know, we're talking about a bird that limits exactly where it's going to be for a month. And it's going to spend all this time, and we'll put up some pictures in a minute, but almost all of its time hanging out, just sitting on the ground in this itty-bitty little area. And then upon hatch for the successful nest, the pullets are kosher. So what that means is people typically get, you know, robins and mockingbirds and that kind of stuff in their yard, or doves that, you know, build a nest in the tree out in the front of the house. And the little nestlings, you know, we get fed by the mom. So the mom and the dad come in and they feed them and everything. It's different with turkeys and with most of your galliforms. They're precocial, which means they're ready to go. They get out of the egg, they dry off, and the poults move right off with the mama. And I know we'll talk about that a little bit later, so I don't want to, you know, go too deep into it now. But that's the general basic biology of turkey nesting ecology.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, man. Those little birds come right out and they're ready to roll. I mean, survival is key. And you think about it, every single thing out there, including folks like us, want to eat them. So no doubt it's important they come out running in order to survive. So that's really cool to know that. Most people probably don't even realize that. I was driving back from turkey hunting this past Saturday, got my last Saturday in. And driving down one of our major roads here, quasi-interstate, and I saw something moving on the center line, and I about ran off the road, but it was two poults actually crossing the road, and they couldn't have been but days old, literally. And I slowed down, and I almost just whipped back around and made the U-ey, but I couldn't do it, and I was thinking, man, how did they get stuck out here? So it's kind of interesting what we see when we're out, and maybe they survived. I don't know. All right, let's get into some more details. I mean, we've kind of started off with a little bit of fun, but I mean, you know, what do you brought up earlier? But are y'all ready to talk about a little bit of sex or what? I mean, wild turkey style. I mean, I'm ready. If y'all ready. All right, here we go. So give me a little details about breeding. Okay. Who selects whom? Is the lady picking out the fellas, or the fellas picking out the lady? How does that work?
Yeah, so it's basically what you've got is you've got males and females, toms and hens, if you will, are separated into groups that have their own hierarchies. You've got basically pecking orders where you've got groups of toms that have a pecking order, and you have groups of hens that have their own pecking order. And basically what happens in the turkey world is they split out of winter flocks. They end up in these groups that we see together in the early spring where you got, say, three or four toms that are together. They have their pecking order. There's a dominant breeder in that group. There's a group of hens that they are spending time around. Let's just say that's eight hens. They have their own pecking order as well. And we see this all the time that, you know, those hens are moving around. Those toms are strutting, following them around. It's the hen that does the selecting. So there's a reason that turkeys look as obnoxious as they do. They have iridescent feathers. They have, you know, red caruncles. They have white skull cap, you know, dewlaps, all beards, all these things that cause them to look showy and gaudy. That's because of sexual selection. They're trying to attract attention to themselves. The hen selects the dominant bird, and not only one dominant bird. Sometimes she will copulate with the dominant tom that's in the group that she's spending time with, and she'll also move about her range and identify other dominant toms or other toms, and she'll copulate multiple times. Some hens will, some hens don't, but some do, and that ends up resulting in multiple toms represented in clutches. So some is, if you, based on some research done, gosh, it's more than a decade ago, showed that some clutches just have one tom represented in it, meaning these birds, and some clutches have multiple birds represented, meaning probably a dominant bird and other birds. And from a, if you think about it from a fitness perspective, that makes sense, because what turkeys do is they store sperm. So she copulates with one of these toms, she stores that sperm, and then when her body is ready to start producing a clutch and fertilizing eggs, her body releases that sperm. So if she copulates with one tom only one time, there's only one stored set of sperm. If she copulates with that tom multiple times, then the sperm that was stored most recently is most viable. And when her body releases that sperm, there's mate competition at that point. Not only did she select the toms that looked the best, that seemed to be the most fit to her, but now there's sperm competition, because when her body releases that sperm, the best sperm wins, right? The most viable sperm wins the competition. So if you think about it from kind of an evolutionary perspective, it makes sense that they would breed either with the same tom multiple times, or they'd breed with multiple toms, because that confers her clutch a better chance at survival, a better fitness advantage, because she's picking, in essence, her body's picking the best sperm. So there's really mate competition at multiple levels in turkeys, which is pretty interesting.
Yeah, that's seriously complicated too. And I can just about guarantee most folks didn't realize that, you know, that her clutch one day could be of multiple suitors, so to speak. And that's really interesting. And, you know, a lot of us that are out there turkey hunting and seeing the action and seeing oftentimes toms that will fight, or I've seen younger birds come into the mix. Even this year, I had seven jakes come in to push a mature bird from a hen. It's pretty interesting. And they were ganging up basically to do that. And so kind of interesting to hear all this and seeing how kind of survival of the fittest, and, you know, how we have evolved and birds have evolved to adapt to, you know, the biggest, strongest, et cetera. Right.
Yep.
Well, that's pretty cool. So let's talk a little bit about kind of the post-copulation or some of the details here. And really, I mean, just how far will a bird go to get a little bit of loving? I mean, come on, let's just break it down real easy. How far are they going to go to get it?
So we talked about it before, and we'll talk about it again. You know, turkeys tend to exist within a what's called an exploded lek system. So the males have a territory or a range that they tend to utilize. It's not particularly defensive in that it's not a defended range where they're going to, you know, mark boundaries and that kind of stuff. It's fairly flexible. And then the females are moving around within that range, interacting with within their range, interacting with these males. You know, typically, what we see from our females that we've caught is that they're fairly consistent where they're captured at and where they end up kind of going out from breeding from. So they don't move a long distance to get bred. They're typically, you know, kind of their winter flock is where they're going to end up being bred at. Now, we have seen some weird movements this year for certain, and in other years. I think Mike on a Turkey Tuesday had posted one of our Louisiana birds that had moved 20 some odd miles. a juvenile female, and that may actually be a result of a dispersal event. It could be that the male or males that are in that particular area are somehow related, siblings, you know, half sibs, cousins, and from a genetic perspective, that's not an optimal place for her to be. We don't typically see the large scale, all the birds start the reproductive season and they scatter. What we typically see is kind of where you're at is where you start your reproductive season from. And then as the season progresses, we tend to see a little bit more movements as they go into second nesting attempts usually. So,
cool, man. Very cool. Well, I'll tell you what, we're having some questions flow here. Thought I'd go ahead and address one real quick. Mr. Marcus Ballard, will a gobbler stay with one hen all mating seasons if conditions permit? Does he have any reason to leave her in order to seek out other hens?
Probably the inverse, Marcus. Probably what happens is that the female, the females that are around him will come to him for reproductive access, and then they leave to go and nest. And then if their nest fails, we do have some preliminary, but I would say stronger evidence we're collecting right now that those females will actually go back to the general area where he was, which we assume is to go back to him for a second copulation or a second breeding attempt. So it's not that the male is sticking with the female, it's that the females are kind of satelliting around the male, or as Mike said, group of males.
Yeah, an important point to think about with males, and this has been shown with turkeys, one of the primary metric for reproductive success in toms is how many different hens you copulate with. That's the primary metric. So the short answer is no, he's not going to stay. You know, to Brett's point, it's kind of the female that's driving that ship, but he's not interested in staying with a single hen. He's interested in copulating with as many hens as he can, because that is the primary metric of his lifetime reproductive success, is how many times can I breed with how many different hens?
Good answers, guys, for sure. Definitely like the way we're going there. Got another good question here, right along the same lines. Mr. Jason Hart, appreciate the comments, brother. Glad to have you on again. How much inbreeding occurs in the wild? And does breeding occur often from the same clutch? And some questions really around DNA and what has really been done there. Good question.
You want to do this, Mike? You want me to?
It doesn't matter.
So it doesn't seem, Jason, like there's enough inbreeding to cause any population level concerns. Some of the earlier work on the molecular ecology and the genetics of reproductive biology in birds have shown that they don't seem to breed with their siblings or anybody that's closely related to them. Now, there are going to be some areas where you are going to get some population bottleneck where just everybody is related, you know, a city park or something like that, where there's no inflow, you know, or ingress or egress of new genetics. But some of that goes back to some of the dispersal that we see, in that the juvenile females tend to get out generally at the beginning of the reproductive season and try and get what we think is away from anybody they might be related to. And then the juvenile males obviously are not active in the reproductive period in the reproductive ecology at this point. So they're not really contributing. So they're kind of distributed themselves across the landscape differently than your more dominant males are. With restocking, it's interesting because there's been some work done in Texas and where birds are coming from. And we don't see a lot of genetic inbreeding depression. And we don't know if that's just luck or if it's just really good mixing from the release cohorts. So I don't think I've ever seen a paper that said that there's an inbreeding depression problem. Have you, Mike?
No. Turkeys aren't really, if you look at how they disperse themselves on the landscape. So you've got these groups, this pecking order of males. So some of them are related to each other, right? So let's just say you have four toms. Well, some of those toms may be brothers, but typically there's only one breeder there. So you have one lineage breeding at that time. And in the hens, you know, as we pointed out before, basically these hens are breeding with these toms and then dispersing across the landscape, at which point they nest, hatch, and then those broods go
all over,
you know, God only knows where. So, and what we see with the jakes is groups of jakes in the spring, this spring, for instance, they'll end up being harvested a mile, 2 miles, 5 miles, 8 miles down the road somewhere. So sometime between the time they're juvenile males and the time they become adults and they end up in these leks as breeders, they're moving far enough on the landscape where inbreeding, it shouldn't really be a concern. But like Bret said, except in extreme cases where you have a really limited number of birds from a limited gene pool, and then you stick them all in the same place and they're kind of isolated. At that point, yes, there would be some inbreeding, but by and large in the wild, we don't see that.
All right. Good answers, fellas. I got another question right here on the roster. Kelly Schott. Let's get this one up. I think this is a good question. Falls right in line with what we're talking about. Will a dominant gobbler, assuming he does most of the breeding, lose feathers and create a bald spot on its breast? Hey, man, you're not talking about my head, are you? If so, this bald spot is a sign of lots of breeding. I ask because I have seen lots of variants of this bald spot over the gobblers I have harvested over the years. Leave it at that. Brett, I know you're laughing. Good question, Kelly. I've heard this question a lot.
It's physiology, isn't it, Mike? I mean, it's reproductive stress is what it is.
I'm going to have to say, I honestly don't have a scientific answer for this. I've seen the same thing in chickens, in barnyard chickens. I suspect there's some validity to it. But what I've noticed, and maybe Kelly, maybe you've noticed the same thing, is that not only is it a bald spot on some birds, but there's also some, it almost is like dermatitis on their skin. They get calluses. And I wonder whether some of that is honestly not the way the bird roost prior to. I've seen some evidence on some birds I've killed that I had no evidence that they were the dominant breeder. In fact, one bird I can remember, he had a bald spot that literally, it almost looked like a volleyball, but he had calluses around it. And the more I postured the bird after I killed him, trying to figure out how he could have gotten all of that, the only plausible scenario I could come up with is for whatever reason, that bird was using a roost at times that he laid on. He was actually laying on his sternum with his feet tucked up under him, and it wore all the feather. That was the only thing I could come up with, because it, whatever it was, had caused calluses on him. And I've gotten a lot of pictures of this on social media, and I honestly don't know the answer to that. I've seen the same thing. I don't know if there's a scientific explanation, honestly.
Mike, I've heard the same thing from a lot of different folks in the turkey arena. Just as we sit in all these different meetings, et cetera, but hearing more so, this could be something from roosting birds, et cetera. So I don't think that the real science is there, but at least there's a lot of the professionals out there thinking along the same lines. That's a good question. Really good question, for sure. All right. We're going to keep this conversation moving a little bit. And it's time to talk about mamas, right? The spouse and the house, so to speak, aka the hen's nest. Does she go out and really search out the best spot, or what? What do you guys think?
I'll do this one. So, a long time ago.
How long ago is a long time?
When I was a grad student.
I was a grad student.
All right.
Before we had the ability to track a bird daily and you have high resolution geospatial data on them, the way that we would go out with VHF and triangulate on these birds, and we'd build a range and try and figure out where they were at. And kind of the general assumption was that these birds would go out, be out in the environment. Yes, it does. in the environment.
Flop them, baby.
And they'd find a spot that looked like somewhere they would want to nest in. And then they would go back and get bred. And then they would go back out to that spot. And that was a data resolution question. And what has happened over, I guess, about the last 7 or 8 years is the theory on that's kind of changed. And the data on that's changed. What we see now is most of the time, most of these birds, and I'm talking 90% plus, never see the place that they're going to nest at until the morning they lay the first egg. So there's no searching that kind of goes on. And I know I've struggled with it. I know Mike has struggled with it on what the adaptive significance of something like that would be. But recently, study after study after study after study has indicated to us that these birds aren't actually searching out, at least on the time scale we thought that they were searching stuff out on. They're not searching it out weeks ahead of time. They're searching it out maybe hours ahead of time, because a lot of these places they've never been before. Now, I will caveat that with there is some evidence of between year range overlap, and we've seen a few birds, not many, but a few adults that have nested within the same general landscape, I guess, as they did the previous year. I know of one specifically in Texas that actually nested underneath the same tree 2 years in a row. But that's the exception, not the rule. So yeah. Our thinking is kind of, my thinking, and I'm sure Mike's thinking on this, has kind of adjusted a little bit in that we originally thought that there was a real strong selection component that these females were making for nesting habitat, and it was made before nesting, and there have been a couple papers that have said it was made before breeding even occurred. But I don't think either one of us is there now. I think now it's more of a, they get bred, it's time to lay an egg, I'm going to go find a spot.
Yeah, they're ready to just drop it like it's hot. It's time. They're going to go, right?
Yeah.
So I'd read somewhere that, I mean, you guys had looked at 700-plus nests.
I don't know what day, right? Today, but sure.
That's crazy. I mean, that's really cool. I mean, you talk about statistical significance when you start looking at a whole bunch of stuff. That's a whole lot of nests, guys. And when we start seeing these large numbers of things we're doing in the research arena, then we can start really starting to define what birds are actually doing. So it's really cool, just some of that information you guys have that I don't think most people would realize. And, you know, even me coming up through school and being a wildlife biologist, hearing about this selection of habitat, et cetera, you know, it just kind of has me scratching my head about, dang, man, what's really going on? And so it's really nice to see this new research and see how we're evolving our thinking on how we do things. So let's just stop for a moment and talk about this. Now, would it be beneficial for us to have what, and I know you've said this before, Mike, I said a lot, a sea of quality habitat for hens to have more success during nesting?
Yeah, it's a tricky question, because what we see is that this bird perceives much of its landscape as nesting habitat. We don't see, to Brett's point, we don't see birds going and picking places that look like prototypical nest habitat as we perceive it. And instead, they are nesting in a variety of places, some of which, honestly, I looked at, I spent the day in the field, and both of the nest sites we visited today, of course, they failed. Neither of them looked like nest habitat to me. One actually didn't look. I can't believe she nested where she did. There was no cover.
Hey, Pete, can you put up the Area 1 picture, please? This would be a good example, Mike.
Yeah, so the bottom line is we don't perceive nest habitat like this bird does, but to your point, if as much of the landscape as possible is what they perceive as being nest habitat, then that's not a pot. It's not a negative for sure. Usable space is kind of what we refer to it as. The more usable space there is, the better off for the bird. The problem is we don't perceive nesting habitat like this bird does. That's become very clear to us. It's startling. In fact, what I think now compared to 20 years ago, when I think about, well, what's nest habitat? I used to have this really defined vision in my head. And the more nest I look at, the more I realize we don't perceive our environment like this bird does. They perceive something entirely different. The way that they go about nesting is different. Like to Brett's point, they don't go looking for the quote unquote best spot. They fly down in the morning and their body tells them it's time to lay a clutch. Let's go find a spot and try to make it work. And it literally looks like that's what they do. That the birds in the south that we're monitoring, that's what they do. They fly down, they go find a place that morning, and they lay a clutch. And sometimes it works out and sometimes it doesn't. Most of the time they fail. Regardless of what the vegetation looks like, it's pretty interesting, because I've been one of the people that published papers saying they selected nests because I inferred it from the telemetry data, and we don't infer much anymore. The GPS data it's spot on, it's high resolution. So we're capturing their behaviors much more accurately than we used to.
This would not be where I would have expected, not to talk over Mike here, but this is not where you would expect a nest to be.
No.
What I have always thought, it's down in the root of the tree next to a town tree, with hardly any vegetative cover. Hey, Pete, can you show the Area 2 picture? This next picture is coming up, and I don't want to speak for Mike, but this is what I would have probably thought nesting habitat looks like if Pete didn't get kicked off. So the only thing I'll add, Jason, here it is, to Mike's point, this is what I would have thought nesting habitat would look like. Mike, what do you think?
Yeah, that, and we're going to talk about this, I know, but that is habitat that's structurally diverse. You got herbaceous vegetation, you got forbs, you got woody vegetation, you've got a hard edge there in the background. She can see, she can hide, which sounds almost nonsensical, but if you think about it, you know, turkeys survive using their vision. So a nesting hen needs to be able to see while also hiding, which is kind of crazy to think about. And then more importantly, she's got to be able to escape if something chases her. So that picture right there, at least in the piney woods of the deep south, that's what I think when I think about nesting cover. But again, a lot of our birds don't end up nesting in a stand like that, even when they have it available to them.
Nope.
So let me throw this curveball in here. Let's say there was three different stand types, and the bird that day decides to drop her eggs, in the non-preferred area, and the likelihood of survival there is probably not as good because of the habitat conditions, maybe from a predator standpoint, maybe to the location, et cetera, more visibility. But let's say we change that. Let's say as active managers went out and did more landscape level, and in this case, maybe the three stands, and had ideal habitat conditions, and knowing this bird's just going to randomly drop, did we just practically increase the opportunity for success by doing that?
Well, no. The bottom line is that if you distribute nesting effort, right? Because what we've seen is this bird, they don't nest on top of each other in general. If either of the two graduate students that I spent the morning with are watching this, they're going to call me a liar.
Yeah. Right now they're doing it. So
we have two that incubated where they could damn near see each other, but that's not typical. Usually you're talking 150, 200 meters between these nests. They're kind of isolated to themselves, which makes sense. So theoretically, if you were to distribute nesting effort more broadly across the landscape, I would logically expect predation to decline because you're distributing nesting effort. The problem, which we're going to talk about in some subsequent episodes here, is that that's under the assumption that nesting effort is compressed in time.
Yep.
In other words, meaning all your hens are incubating at the same time. Therefore, you have a predator swamping effect by distributing nests broadly and at the same time. And we don't see that in southeastern populations. What we see is a very long window of time that nests are occurring on the landscape. And therefore, the spacing does not appear to matter at this point because they're on the landscape for 90 plus days. And if you think about it, there's no predator swamping. If you got birds nesting from March until the 1st of July, there's no swamping. So that's really kind of a confounded question. I think it's effort spatially, but the time has to be right. And the time is not right. Talk about it. It's taking too long for this bird. It's taking too long for them to nest right now in the South. It's their nesting season is taking way too long to get completed.
Yeah.
Hmm. Why do you think it's taking too long?
We're going to talk about that. It's a variety of reasons. It's thing from hen physiological condition. It's their mating system. It's their dominance hierarchies. It's the availability of males. It's habitat. It's
green up. Yeah. It's climate. Yeah. It's thermoregulatory limitations. It's harvest. It's a lot
of stuff going on.
All right.
And we're trying to get our heads around a lot of it, honestly. It's a lot to think about.
It brings an interesting note here. I'll plug some of the research that one of my graduate students, Aaron, is doing right now, in that when we talk about how these birds kind of go out on the landscape to nest, they don't nest in – so incubation doesn't start in bunches. We don't see 8 turkeys from a flock all running around together, all go out and nest on the same day. It's not at all. And my assumption was it was about one day in between. I mean, just generally speaking. What we're really seeing right now is that the lag between the first bird, which we would assume has higher social dominance and be higher in the pack because she bred first, the first bird to go out, The window is somewhere between about 3 and 5 days before the next female goes out. So if you assume a group of, say, 8 or 10 females that are reproductively engaged with the males that are copulating in a staggered fashion, you know, you can be 20 to 30 plus days out before all of them have even had their quote-unquote return in line. And where this actually gets more confounding, which we've seen evidence of, is that if the first bird fails, she reinserts herself at the top of the hierarchy when she goes back. So she will breed first, go out, have a nest, maybe it'll fail 7 or 8 days in, and then she'll actually go back into the breeding flock, reestablish her automatically reestablished as the dominant female, rebreed, and then she'll go out again before some of the other females have even bred and went to nest the first time. So there's a really interesting and I think more complex dynamic going on in the reproductive biology of the bird that admittedly I thought whenever, you know, 20 years ago, now I started working on it.
That's pretty cool, man. It's a seriously complicated issue. And thinking about some things that we'll address on some future episodes, which I am very hungry to have the discussion about. I'm looking forward to us having some more discussion to how do we figure some of this out? What do we need to do, et cetera? But listen, I'm going to stop for a second. We're getting like a firestorm of some questions. I want to address a few of these before we get too far down the path here. Real quick, I'm going to back up. Mr. Randall Otis has a question for us. I'm going to try to get it addressed first.
We'll just plow through them real quick. 40 seconds, please.
Whew, I'm going to hammer. All right. Is nest scratching pre-copulation? And is this a good gauge of when mating is ramping up?
Post-copulation.
Pre-copulation.
Pre-copulation. Nothing doesn't start to watch the birds bred and move off. There's a good gauge of when mating is ramping up. When you start seeing him heading off, yeah, it's a good gauge.
Okay. Very good. Thank you for the question, Randall. We're going to move on down here and see if we got another one here. Maybe Nash Green. Let me check here. Pete, you got that one? All right. Any reason for multiple hens to be together with young poults?
Go ahead, Mike.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So this bird is supposed to, they're supposed to amalgamate these broods. That's part of their ecology. So these hens that hatch, they are supposed to group up in the summer once those birds get a certain size. They're supposed to end up in groups. If they don't, they have a disadvantage because those brood hens, the more eyes, right, there's more vigilance. We've actually seen evidence that if you see groups of hens with poults, not all of those hens actually had poults. I've seen this numerous times through the years where I know for a fact that some of the hens that ended up in these brood flocks in the summer weren't brooding. They were hens that either went far into incubation and failed or just failed at some point, and they end up socializing in these groups. I can only speculate that they're related to one of those hens that ended up hatching. But the bottom line to your question is, yes, they're supposed to end up in those large groups. That's safety in numbers.
Good answer. Yeah, definitely safety in numbers. All right, we're going to address another question real quick before we move on down the list of items we're going to cover this evening. Let's look here at Mr. Jeff Craig. Real quick, if a hen poult is hatched in a certain area, does she have any fidelity to that same area to lay her own clutch?
Yeah, unknown, Jeff, but I don't think that there's particularly faithfulness or fidelity of the females to that exact area. Now, there might be faithfulness to the general range, but I don't think there's faithfulness to, you know, the 2,000 acres that she was found in, because we do see a lot of female dispersal. I mean, we just do. They tend to get away from their maternal flocks in the spring. And I think some of that's due to just who the females are breeding with and who may be in the male group. So I don't think faithfulness in they come back to the same house every year type of thing, but they may stay in the same general area. Yeah.
Tough question to answer.
Tough question. Data on it. Right.
We don't have data on that. That's a tough question because you actually need to track the poult, which is tough to do without biasing your data. And then you have to be able to recapture that bird and monitor her through time. That's largely unknown, but I completely agree with Brad. Logically, I don't think it occurs given the way this bird disperses when they're juveniles.
Great answer, guys, and great question. Thanks for that. I got another one I'm going to tee up for you fellas. From Mr. James Manning. Do you think it's possible that when it's time to lay an egg, she has to lay and make do with the best possible place?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. We see evidence of this a lot.
Yeah.
Yep. At 7 o'clock in the morning, later first egg at 9, in a place that looks almost nonsensical. How she arrived at the conclusion that that would work for 28 days is beyond me. And yeah, we do have strong evidence to suggest that some of these birds do that. They fly down and they just make a go of it.
James, I had a bird move 6.5 miles one day and never had been to that area before, juvenile female. And the next morning she dropped her first egg at 8 o'clock in basically a rock pile.
Yeah.
No reason to be there.
All right, one more, guys, and then we'll move on. From Mr. Anthony Mills. Let's throw this one into the hopper. I've heard that some hens never try to nest. Is that true? And if so, for what cause is this?
You want to do this one, Mike?
Whatever.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so, yes, we do. We have a percentage of our marked birds every year that don't attempt They exhibit no signs of laying. They never incubate a clutch. There are multiple causes for that. One of those is just physiological condition of the bird. Some of these birds, for whatever reason, may not be predisposed from a physiological standpoint to be able to produce a clutch. Some of these hens may not end up being bred, although we doubt that occurs at a wide scale. Some of these birds are actually nest parasites. They lay eggs in other birds' clutches, which is a lot of people don't know that that functions in turkey populations, but we see it in every population we've monitored throughout the South, that there are a percentage of these birds that are parasitic, like cowbirds. They go and lay an egg here, an egg there, in someone else's clutch. Most of the times we see that it's with hens they hung around with during the laying sequence. So think three hens out, one scoots off over here and lays an egg in a clutch. Her sister or her buddy sees her do it. A couple of days later, she sneaks over and lays her clutch in that egg. And that makes sense if you think about it. You're basically shirking your parent responsibility, right? You're putting your eggs in someone else's basket and letting them hatch your clutch for you or a single egg for you. So I think if you wrap all that together, that's that fairly small percentage of hens that never nest.
And the only thing I'd add to that, Anthony, is that, and Mike's exactly right, is that we do tend generally to see juvenile females be less likely to attempt to nest than adult females. Not always, not widespread across the study, but typically if you're going to have, if you think about who's not going to nest, it's going to typically be some of your juvenile females. Juveniles a little bit more regularly.
Man, great question, Anthony. Appreciate the answers, fellas. No doubt. I know we'll probably hit on another one right here. I wanted to stop, but this question kind of hit me because, and I'll tell you, I've had this question very similar here. We've had some absolutely cold weather, uncalled for. I mean, my garden, guys, I mean, it's supposed to be like May 1 is planting day for everything. No more frost. Well, we got frost last week, and I'm out there bagging and stacking and trying to save everything. And we've seen some unusual weather this year. So this is going to go around some of these cold, freezing temps, et cetera. So I think, let's see who we got here. Andy Olson.
Yep. Former UGA student.
Come on.
Go Dawgs. Yeah.
Oh, he's got a complicated question, too. Let's see if we can get it up so everyone can see it before I rattle it off.
It's actually,
all right, I'm going to rattle it anyway. Are y'all ready? Here we go. Any info about egg laying and ambient temps? Here in North Central, we have been having unusual prolonged cold temps, multiple snow events, temps into the low 20s at night and mornings with highs in the 30s and 40s. From the hunter observations, it seems that gobblers are still covered up with hens. Seems like they are delaying egg laying.
It's a little early up in the Northeast for you guys to be fully ramped up into reproduction, if I'm not mistaken, based on the timing data that's out there. But to your point, yeah, I mean, birds aren't going to typically go out in suboptimal conditions and lay eggs. The primary issue with freezing is cracking of the egg or freeze overnight. They're usually resilient, but they're not perfectly resilient. But I also think that it might be it's cold. We had some freezes and everything. Might be a tad early still. For the being hinned up, if all the females are still hanging out with the males, that tells me that reproduction hasn't really ramped up in that area yet. So I think I got that. And if I didn't, you can email me and I'll follow up with you.
Yeah, no, that's what I'd say too. Basically, we see that you'll see some minor changes in the kind of the chronology of how this works if you get these severe weather events like that. The bottom line from her perspective is it doesn't make any sense to lay an egg when it's 20 degrees at night, because even though she covers the eggs, and turkeys aren't really great about covering eggs, they do cover them during laying, but not like ducks do. So it doesn't make any sense for her to enter into an egg laying sequence again physiologically, they're wired to store sperm and then release sperm right when it's time to nest. So if the weather throws her a curveball, we see this all the time. You'll see a little minor change here and there. We're not talking weeks on end. You may see some shifts based on those cold weather events.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. I'll add in a little additional question here on top of what was just asked. And I've had some professionals that I've had communications with, even here in other states locally, were concerns about the broods this year, especially with these birds being on nest. And we've had some absolutely cold weather for multiple days, a heck of a lot more rain, et cetera, and just some concerns on nest success right now. And it sounds like you really hit on that with these absolutely colder temps and birds being on the nest. There's probably a little higher probability they're not going to pull off as successful of a nest. Would that be correct?
Well, incubation's different.
Yeah.
Incubation's different because at that point, she can adjust her own behavior to influence egg temperatures. So as long as she's sitting there, her ambient temperature is enough to incubate that clutch, right? So as long as she doesn't take extended incubation recesses, even when it's really cold, she can still make it work. The problem becomes, you know, I'm thinking cold temperatures not for incubating hens. I'm thinking laying sequence and then more importantly, poults. You get super cold weather when you've got broods on the ground and there's only a certain number of poults that can get under her at a time, particularly as they get, you know, 8, 10, 12 days old. That's when I'm concerned about cold temperatures, not so much when she's incubating.
Okay. Well, a lot of questions right now about the temps all across the board.
Yeah.
And it's got a lot of our average folks and professionals really concerned, especially after seeing what kind of a year we've had in the turkey woods and harvest, et cetera. Some things I know we'll cover on some future episodes for sure. All right, I'm going to dive into a couple more just general topics before we hit some more questions because we're getting a lot of great questions come in, and we're going to try to address as many of them as we can. I know we were talking a little bit about incubation, et cetera, and we're just curious, guys, what's that average range for a hen via incubation? We know what the average home range is. We've talked about that on a couple of the previous episodes of what birds use, but let's just talk about incubation. How much area would this bird be using at that time frame?
Yeah, sure. So from the day, we'll just kind of do it the day the female sits, right? Because she may have roosted off the night before a kilometer or a couple of miles away. But basically, from the time the female sits on the nest until the time the nest hatches, she uses what is basically an incubation range. And we estimate that range is about 20 acres. Now, there's a lot of ecological flex in that number, right? Some birds have long 20 ranges. Some birds have these incubation ranges that may, you know, run up and down a riparian corridor. Some of these birds have round ranges. Some of these birds have ranges that look like a triangle, and their nest is down on the bottom, and they only go one direction off of it. And they only go north; they never go south. We see evidence of that pretty clearly sometimes. But I think that about the amount of area these birds use is right around 20 acres for the 28-day kind of incubation sequence.
20 acres—that's pretty cool, man. Just thinking about how much area a bird can cover throughout the year. And they're really honed in. That's pretty tight compared to what they're averaging throughout the year. So
it's one of those things, and I've used this analogy before, Michael Grenier in a second, but it's the equivalent basically, if you live in a 2400 square foot house, to spend a month in your downstairs bathroom.
Yeah.
That's the easiest analogy. And you got to have everything you need in that bathroom. You got to have food. You got to have water. You got to try to avoid being predated. I mean, it probably doesn't occur in bathrooms that often, but you get the drift.
Man, good answer, man. Appreciate that intel. That's something that I think folks will really think about when they're out thinking about nesting, et cetera. But so tell me, I mean, is there some kind of internal driver? Is it genetics? Is it the sixth sense? I mean, or is it a strategy that hens use for their nest sites?
You mean, what do you mean for their nest sites?
How they behave? I mean, as far as, you know, as far as where they're going to be, I mean, I know we've talked about, hey, they're just going to drop. They're going to drop and they're going to sit down and go, hey, this is the place, right? And it, whatever time of the day, whatever day of the week, when it's time, it's time. But is there something else driving that? I mean, is there anything in that bird's mind that we need to know about that's dictating this?
Well, they do have strategies, it appears. So what we found pretty clearly is hens are taking two different approaches once they lay that clutch. Some of these hens spend a lot of time at the nest, almost all the time, every day, day and night at the nest. If they leave for a recess, they don't go far and they don't stay gone long. Think an hour, 100 yards away. Those hens tend to be more successful nesters. On the flip side, there's the group of hens that tend to, it seems to us, tend to prioritize their own survival over reproduction. They tend to leave the nest more often. They tend to stay gone longer. When they do leave the nest, they go farther distances away. That makes complete sense to me because we typically think of a nest as being really a dangerous place, right? There's a lot of scent. She's coming back and forth to this spot every day. Predators can track her movements. If you're going to go prioritize your own self-maintenance, go away from that spot. So there seems to be two strategies. The hens that spend more time around the nest tend to hatch better, but on the flip side, they die more often. And the hens that leave more often and stay gone longer tend to have much lower nest success, but they have higher individual survival. So there's kind of two strategies here.
Okay, cool.
And it's an interesting trade-off if you think about it, because, and Mike's exactly right, this is what almost all the information that we're collecting shows, but it's, do I stay and really try to be successful, or do I retreat and stay alive so that I can try again next year?
Yeah.
That's really, and it's a very complicated decision, and I have no idea what causes one individual to choose one way and one individual to choose another, but we see it very, I think, very clearly. There are some females that are just locked in, and there are some that, I mean, hell, they care less. You know, they get up and move 500 yards off, and their nest fails. They don't care. They just go on with their day. So
yeah, spend 3 hours off the clutch at a time.
There's
a lot going on here we don't really understand, but there definitely does appear to be strategies that this bird uses. I would say this bird's supposed to live a long time. Mm-hmm. So this bird is supposed to be able to live multiple nesting years. And if you think about it, the second strategy makes sense.
Another day, yep.
Yeah, so it does make sense to me that a lot of birds would be wired like that because they're supposed to live multiple years and they're supposed to be able to try multiple times. So maybe don't prioritize reproduction, because if you're wired evolutionarily to live, let's say 5 years or 6 years or whatever, just wait till next year and you know, give it a go. Seriously.
Yeah.
Wait till next year, give it a try every year. And if it works out, great. And if it doesn't, you know what? Go hang around with your lady friends midsummer, wine, smoke cigars, and have a good time. And don't put yourself.
Let's take it now. We're supposed to be talking about, you know, happy wife, happy life. Man, I'm telling you, some of them are real happy though, right?
Happy wives that get to spend time together at the beach in groups, smoking cigars and drinking wine. Those are happy wives.
We just got off.
But, I don't know about cigars. I mean, but whatever.
But whatever, right? Right. But whatever their crux is, right?
Yeah.
Along with my point, you know, it's important to realize something in that the southeastern United States climactically, and the eastern United States actually, is fairly consistent in climate. Right? We don't see massive spikes of changes in weather where we go to 20 degrees for a month in June, right? We don't see massive waves of precipitation that just change where we get 8 feet all of a sudden or something. And think about that from a bird's perspective. If I'm pulse driven and I want to be able to nest in the best conditions, if it's not a good condition for me, I'd rather live. The southeast is fairly consistent. You go west and everything starts getting semi-arid. You actually tend to skew more towards females being significantly more willing to abandon a nest site as opposed to sticking with it because they're thinking, it's dry, it's hot, I'm not going to do this year. And they're going to head on the fact that next year will be better. And there's actually a lot of evidence for that in turkeys and in quail and in a few other of the western species.
Yeah, Rio's are notorious for that. If it's dry, give it one shot and quit. Be done with it. Wait till next year.
Yeah. Wow.
Maybe it'll rain by next year and there'll be enough vegetation to hide in.
It's interesting just to hear it that way. And yeah, I guess there's a little more southeastern hospitality here or something. We'll leave it at that. A little more charm with our birds rather than some of the other ones. But it's crazy to think about that in such a way and how impactful that can be for sure. All right, let's. I do have a question. We had a couple questions pop up. I'm gonna hit one of these right here, out of Missouri, so to speak. One of our Missouri Department of Conservation experts has a question. Raina, she is our turkey technical rep for the state.
Hey, Raina.
What's up? All right. How can landowners with predominantly forested properties improve nesting and brood rearing habitat on their properties? And how about landowners with more open agriculturally dominated properties? Habitat question. I like it.
You want to do the first half, I'll do the second, or just want to roll with it?
Whatever. Whatever. I would say, based on my way of thinking, at least the landscapes that we work in, nesting habitat is not nearly as problematic as brood habitat. We see in fact, today I visited a stand that a brood is in currently. And if you had told me 20 years ago that a stand like that looked like this would be used as brood habitat, I would have thought you were insane. This did not look like brood habitat. I generally tell landowners that contact me, look around you, and if you think you can hide a turkey in a stand, then most turkeys probably think they can hide in that stand. Nesting habitat is more ubiquitous than we thought it was. Now, most nests are failing, so that may not be a positive, but I look at brood habitat as being much more problematic. And the analogy I give people is, if you want to think about, is this brood habitat or not, go lay down on your stomach and look around you. And if you're a three-day-old poult, for instance, and we see a lot of death between day one and day three or four, if you can't see laying on your stomach, neither can they. If you couldn't move around, basically snaking around on your stomach, then they can't either. And then flip over on your back. And if you flip over on your back and you stare around you, if you don't see something you could go hide under fairly close to you, it's not brood habitat. And then hop up on your knee. If you're sitting there on your knee and you can see for the most part, then so can that brood hen. So that's how I tell people to assess brood habitat. And if you can't answer yes to all three of those, then you're putting the bird at a disadvantage. So whatever you have to do to disturb the habitat, to create those conditions, that needs to happen. This video right here that you're actually seeing, this is a stand that a brood used. And as you look through this stand, you see some really important things. One is the stand is not homogeneous, meaning the vegetative structure is very diverse. There's some taller stuff. There's some shorter stuff. There's bare ground. As we're panning going through it, you can see places where there's bare ground. You don't see a tremendous amount of woody vegetation in this stand. Instead, you see a lot of forbs and you see a lot of legumes, a lot of herbaceous plants. That means disturbance, means lots of bugs. And that structure, those different stages of vegetative structure, that allows poults of multiple ages to forage. So you've got tiny, tiny little poults. You got poults that are 2 weeks old. You got poults that are 28 days old. Once they get older, they're voracious. I mean, they're really aggressive foragers. They'll climb up on vegetation. They'll flap up on top of vegetation. So as you've got that tiered structure in those stands that they can get under and hide, that's brood habitat. And I think when most people go out and lay down on the ground and they start thinking about that video right there, you'll realize that a lot of our landscape is not good brood habitat. There's a lot of nesting cover out there. And I think in many ways, we've been infatuated with cover for years through our own doing. Cover, cover, cover.
Yeah.
And as we've seen, cover is not the panacea. We can hatch nests, but if we don't get broods to survive, we've done nothing. So as I drive around the Southeast, I don't see a lack of nesting cover per se. What I see is rich predator communities and a really overwhelming lack of quality brood habitat. That's my take on it.
Yeah, good answer, guys. Hey, Pete, could you bring up
disturbance?
Disturbance is key. Disturbance.
So to Raina's question, if you own forested land and you're not disturbing it, you're not managing it for wild turkeys. That's
2 to 3 year interval too. I'm just going to throw out there. Ideally, if we could disturb on a 2 to 3 year interval across the landscape, boom, we're going to have some pretty good habitat out there in general.
And hey, disturbance can be anything. Disturbance can be timber harvest. It can be timbered stand improvement.
Thanks, Steve.
It can be prescribed fire. It can be strip disking, fall disking, spring disking.
All of it.
Number of disturbances, but the bottom line in forested landscapes, if you're not disturbing soil in general, you're not producing and more importantly, sustaining brood habitat. Bottom line.
Yeah, 100%. Hey, Pete, bring up the right of way picture real quick. Since we're talking a little bit about habitat, figured it'd be a good time to bring this one up. This is a picture, you know, oftentimes, you know, some of our partners that are out there, on even some of our federal lands, sometimes the only area you'll see good habitat is along right-of-ways. I've seen this working with a ton of national forests out there. And this is just a picture from our Energy for Wildlife program. It's a right-of-way habitat endorsement program. This is Enable. I think this is a pick out of Arkansas. And I tell you what, they're keeping that disturbance regime there and really providing some quality brood range. And of course, some nesting habitat, but really good brood range over time because of their disturbance regime. And oftentimes what we see along these right-of-ways, sometimes it has the most diverse habitat that we'll find out there. And then also it's the best maintained on the interval that we are wanting to see to provide that quality habitat for turkeys. And oftentimes people overlook those kind of areas as opportunities. And I saw that pick and I thought it'd be a good kind of transition into, you know, trying to manage at a larger level in order to be more impactful for a species that covers a whole lot of ground, right? Mm-hmm. Whole lot of ground. So appreciate sharing that pick there for sure. I do have a couple other questions that have popped up. We'll try to address these since they are hitting on here. Cheers to you, Mike. You're going to make me want to sip again. Appreciate that. Let's see here. Vincent Meyer. Let's see if we can get this question up. Vincent Meyer, is there any relation between bird age for nesting strategy? Stay near nest or go far away? Good question, Vincent.
Go ahead, Mike.
Yeah, we don't know. If you're asking about age relative to, am I a juvenile or adult? We don't see a tremendous amount of nesting effort from our juvenile birds. Well, first of all, we don't have a tremendous percentage of our hens, period, that are juvenile birds because our production is quite low. But we don't see a lot of nesting effort from juvenile hens. Some. once the bird gets to be a two-year-old, we don't know how old she is. Unless we can track her for multiple years, we don't really know. So the answer to your question is, once they get to be two, we don't really have an answer to that, unfortunately, because these transmitters that we use, they typically only last a year, maybe into a second year. So for some hens, we actually do have multiple years, but not the 500 plus that we have kind of the strategy data on, if you will.
The only thing I'd add to Mike's answer, which is exactly right, is that generally adult females will try to re-nest. Juvenile females, more often than not, they're one and done. And I'm not, that's a pretty broad picture that I'm using, but I think it's fairly accurate.
Mm-hmm.
Good question, guys. Good answer, too, as well. Let's talk a little bit about maybe some of our specific metrics, numbers. Like, what's the percentage of females out there that attempt to nest?
Year-to-year variation, understanding, I think you're going to see somewhere on average between 70 and 90.
Yeah, the average is about 80.
Yes, somewhere, sometimes it'll get up to 100, sometimes it'll be down in the low 60s, but yeah, somewhere around 80% is probably the mean.
B minus, that's good. It'd be great if it's higher, but we'll go with that. What about, what's the distribution of nests that are actually initiated or via incubation?
Oh, man. Temporarily?
Yeah.
You're going to see your big pulse about the beginning, middle of April in the southeast. Second week of April is when we're going to start. So this is important. When we talk about a pulse, it's not all in one day. This is a 2 to 3 week period that we're encapsulating here. So it's a curve, you know, it kind of goes up and then comes back down. So the peak of that pulse is probably late third week of April, Mike, I would assume. We tend to see most of them start in about the second week. When we get to the peak about the third week of April, and then it kind of trails off in May. And then there's a second reproductive pulse in about a week from now, maybe a week or two from now, that we see. And then there's always stragglers on the back end. And then on the front end, you get the random bird that starts incubating on the 27th of March. But that's very much the exception, as opposed to the bulk of them being in the middle of April, middle to end of April. Everything, you know, the farther north you go, the later that gets. The farther west you go, the later that gets.
Hmm. Very cool. Hey, good question here. What can we read about these studies?
Shoot us an email.
I'll give the guys my website. I try and keep everything Mike and I jointly write up on my LSU website is PDFs. Let me shoot that over to them real quick.
Yeah, we archive everything on Brett's site. On every journal article we've ever co-authored on this stuff, dozens and dozens of articles on pretty much any topic you can think of.
That's awesome, guys. Good question for sure. I'm going to throw another one out as Brett is working his magic on the computer here. What's the percentage of re-nest out there? And maybe the percentage of successful nest?
Yeah, so the percentage of successful nest, we're talking about kind of overall, is about 20 to 22% across our sites right now. We see some, as you would expect, year-to-year variation. 1 year, it averages 28, 1 year it averages 19 or whatever, but about 20 to 25% will hatch. Renesting is highly variable across sites and years. On some study sites, we see really high rates of renesting, 50 plus 60%, a lot of birds renesting. And in other landscapes, we see it's 30, 40%. Renest are kind of complicated. What we've generally seen is renest are smaller clutches. They tend not to be as successful. But on some sites, a lot of broods are produced. One of our South Georgia study sites, we produce, in fact, as many broods were produced from re-nest as from initial nest. But that's not the typical pattern. The typical pattern is you want those initial clutches to succeed. And if you do, if you do, great. If you don't, about half your birds are not going to try again. And if they do try again, they're going to try again with smaller clutches that have poor success. Mm. So if that answers the question.
Yeah. Yeah. Thought I'd throw a few quick number questions out for you guys. Let's talk a little bit about the broods. You know, the AKA, go ahead.
That was what I was going to say is, I mean, the important number here is 7%. When you start breaking down the number of birds that nest, the number of nests that are successful, and the number of broods that actually survive, you know, you get down into maybe having 7% of your total nest bring off one poultry.
Yeah. Yeah. So basically take these numbers. If you take these numbers and work the math out. So if you take 100 hens, 80 of them will actually try incubating a clutch. Okay. So 20 of them are off the table.
Yep.
Of those 80, about 20 to 22% hatch.
Yeah.
At least one egg. Of those, about 35% of those clutches that hatch actually produce a poult, one or more poults that live a month. That ends up being about 7% of all the nests on the landscape produce one or more poults that survive a month.
Sure.
So that 7%, if you start thinking about the odds that one of these birds lives to be one of the toms that we call up in the spring or one of these hens that are in these flocks in the winter, the odds are astronomical that it doesn't happen. Every bird is truly the golden egg. That's the way I look at it. Every one of these things that survives past a month, much less to be an adult,
yeah,
has defied astronomical odds to get there. It's remarkable.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. All right, guys. We got a question coming in. I'm going to address this one. It has to be, I think, one of my hillbilly friends, Mr. Curtis Taylor, out of West Virginia.
Hey, Curtis.
We all know him. What's up, Curtis? We got a question coming in. Let's see what it is. I think it's about juvenile hens versus adult hens in regards to nesting, re-nesting. Good question, Curtis.
Keep
joining.
Well, first of all, the fact that Curtis is asking this question makes me laugh because he probably knows as much about
it. He knows the answer.
Yeah, he knows. The door just got kicked open, and my dog just walked in. So chaos is about ready to erupt. Okay. My wife dog in, so I apologize, everybody. Curtis knows the answer. So here's what I would say. When Curtis was doing his research in the Virginia, West Virginia area, I suspect they saw a fairly high rate of juvenile female re-nesting, significantly better than we see now. Most, Curtis, I would say probably 80% of our adults will re-nest. For juveniles, I'd say over the last 10 or 15 years, it's dropped since I started doing this, and I think it's probably somewhere around 20 to 25% off the top of my head. I don't think that our juvenile females re-nest very often at all.
No. Yeah, to Brett's point, and Curtis, he knows this, but it's a good question for the audience. Is 30 years ago, not only did you see juvenile hens re-nesting, but more importantly, you saw juvenile hens that were actually contributing in some populations a significant amount of nesting effort.
Yeah.
Meaning they were nesting and more importantly, they were hatching. And what we see across the South by and large now is that that's not common at all. One, the percentage of juveniles in our flocks is much less than it used to be. About 10 to 11% of all the hens we put our hands on are juveniles. That's much lower than it used to be 30 years ago, meaning we're not having females being recruited into these flocks in the winter. The bottom line is we're not producing as many female poults, poults in general. More importantly is that group of juveniles, they're not contributing to nesting like we used to see back in the 1980s and early 90s. So we can't really count on those juveniles, which is unfortunate. And the answer to why that is not something you can just put your finger on and identify cleanly. But the bottom line is juvenile hens don't contribute like they did historically to our populations. And that's a real cause for concern because in essence, it almost takes out a segment of your hen population every year. And you can just say, well, if she doesn't make it until next year, she's not going to contribute for the most part to our populations. And that's not how we saw turkeys function 30 or 40 years ago.
Not how all the models that we've used to kind of structure turkey population dynamics and evaluate the impacts of regulation timing and environment and everything, they're all based on a general assumption that juvenile females provide production. And we just don't see that now.
Yeah.
Good question, Curtis. Good answers, fellas. I'm going to throw another one at y'all real quick here. Mr. Josh Perry. And this can be a complicated question, but we're going to try to address it as easy as possible. What easy steps can someone take to improve turkey habitat / help population specifically if you aren't a landowner?
If you're not a landowner, the things I would recommend is one, buy a hunting license.
Amen, brother.
Two, support organizations like NWTF. I'm not just saying that because I'm sitting here. Three is get engaged in the turkey hunting community. Get engaged with people that are decision makers. Talk to your local biologist. Talk to your commissioners. Talk to your state board of directors. Make your voice heard. Get involved in any way you can in the turkey hunting / management community. Network with people that are landowners. If you have information and they don't, if you're a steward of the science, if you will, and you know landowners that you can get in their ear and you can convey information to them, do it and try to have an impact on a footprint that maybe you don't own, but you have a voice that could influence. That would be my recommendations.
Yep.
Man, I agree with that. I could pour out a little bit of passion right here in a stump speech about what we need to do to work together, et cetera. And man, it's a team effort. It's a partnership. It's collaboration. And yes, we appreciate folks supporting NWTF, but we have partner groups and organizations out there that we work with closely, the state agencies closely, the federal agencies closely, because we're a team of folks. And you know what we care about? Conservation. Bottom line. We care about responsible recreation. Bottom line. We care about the wild turkey. Bottom line. So it takes a group of folks that's committed and they're passionate about what we're doing. We have corporate partners out there. They're right here with us, walking the line with us. So we encourage you to join us in these efforts because it does take a team, as I would call it, a family flock to make things happen. So we appreciate the support. We appreciate you going out and supporting our local, state, and federal agencies too. Because we are all a team and we're all in this together, no doubt. And I'll stop there because I could keep on preaching, guys. All right. Great question so far. I mean, I'm pretty stoked. We're almost at the hour and a half mark already. And if we keep things rolling in, we'll keep going a little bit longer as long as we have people on here and wanting to ask questions. We still have some things to hit on broods. So I'm going to throw this question out to you guys real quick. About our little broods, and I call them AKA little puffballs, right? I mean, the little poults. Tell us about poults as far as what does that look like the first days, the first week, you know, anything after they hatch? What does that time frame look like for our broods? Go, fellas.
Yeah, so for a poult and a brood, basically you hatch, you're attending hen, is trying desperately to get you away from that nest. So she has spent 28 days synchronizing you, trying to get you to leave. Get right. So she walks the brood away from that nest. And what we found is she gets them several hundred yards away the first day. And then ideally she slows down and takes her time and they work their environment. Basically what you see is poults actually drive the train. It's not the hen. The hen gets the poults to certain places in the landscape and then she lets them forage and she kind of shepherds and facilitates the process. So you tend to see broods forage in a line, almost like an army, with the hen standing around vigilant. These things pop out, you know, they're tiny when they're hatched and they grow like weeds every day. They go through rapid plumage changes. They grow flight feathers very quickly. So within 2 weeks, they're up off the ground. In most cases, 8 or 9 days, they're actually making little short jumps and flights. To do that, you got to eat a lot of bugs and you don't want to move much. So what we've seen is broods that move a lot die. And the only conceivable reason that a hen would move her brood a long distance or constantly is because she feels like she has to, because they're not encountering the prey that they need. So they move. So a brood on the move is dead. A brood that's stationary and doesn't move much, quality forage, she can stay vigilant. They grow quickly. And then to one of the earlier questions, what they're supposed to do is after a few weeks, they're supposed to amalgamate with other broods. And at that point, their survival skyrockets. 2 weeks in, they're off the ground at night with mom. They start foraging up off the ground. They climb up in things. They jump onto things. And then after by a month, they're pretty much hunky-dory. They're rooster size. And we assume at that point that they're pretty much good to go.
This picture here is actually a successful nest in a stand that, going back to last week, had a prescribed burn to put to it. And those are a couple of, I think it's two or three in there, fresh hat poles that haven't actually left the nest yet. This was I'm not sure if this was a nest that the guy stumbled up on. I think they thought it was farther away. But he had just had it out. You can actually see the fire star on the nest. Mike, was this the hen that we think put it out?
What's that?
Was this the hen that was out in that big open stand? Was it Andy's or was this a different one?
I don't recall what clutch exactly this was. We've had a number of, yeah. We don't have many that have been affected by fire like we talked about last week, but this is really typical of what it looks like. You tend to see, at least in cooler fires, that the nest bowl is actually not impacted. It's not affected at all. Now, obviously, we've all seen pictures of nest bowls that were completely scorched by fire, but we see this quite a bit. But those poults right there, those are one-day-old poults. So you look at the size of those things, they're just slightly larger than the egg that they popped out of. And in 2 weeks, they're young chicken size. And in a month, they're rooster size. So this bird grows really quickly if they have a lot of protein, which is how they build that body, right? And protein is bugs. So when you're thinking brood habitat, you're thinking about broods. If you're the habitat question comes up a lot. You know, we've talked about structure. When I walk around and I see bugs flushing in front of me, that's a good thing. If I'm walking along and it structurally looks okay, but I'm like, I don't know if a brood would use this, and if they did, if it would be high quality. If you don't see bugs moving, spiders flushing under your feet, if you don't see grasshoppers moving, if you don't see things flushing in front of you, you're not in good brood habitat. That means that those poults are going to have to forage constantly. And although they're supposed to forage constantly, the more they forage and don't intake prey, the more energy they burn for the energy they gain. And as we've talked about, what they need to do is grow big fast. And if they're not taking in as much energy, then they don't grow as fast. So you're looking here at, I mean, these poults are about a week old.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, if you look at the timestamp on that, that's July 15th. That's a clutch that was hatched at the very, very end of June, 1st of July. Historically, we would not even consider looking at broods in the middle of July that were that size. By that time, back in my day when I was a grad student, we caught broods in the middle of July to put leg bands on them because they were already rooster sized. So you could actually reliably sex them using their tarsus length, their leg length at that age. So in this particular case, you're seeing a really young brood late in the season, which we're gonna talk about, and we've already kind of briefly touched on today. But yeah, what you're seeing there is, I mean, if you look, the poults are kind of around the hen, and they're kind of doing their own thing. And what those birds are looking for is encounter rates. The more bugs they encounter, the better. And as one starts encountering, the poults will come to it, right? And you start seeing this kind of mob mentality. That's what you see with broods when they're foraging. Somebody finds something, and you see pecking increase, and then here comes everybody else. You see the same thing in winter flocks when suddenly Betty stumbles upon some acorns under a white oak, and here all the buddies coming in. You know, right. And that, as an aside, we've talked about these pecking orders. These pecking orders in turkey start from day one. So even in these broods that are a couple of weeks old, they're already starting to try to get their pecking orders established at an early age because the assumption there, right, in their mind, they're all surviving. They don't know one day to the next. They just know that social structure is dictating their lives. Not only does it dictate their life when they're 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 years old, it dictates life when you're a poult. So they start really early.
Man, good intel there for sure. I had a question pop up, and this is a little bit more about the nest, but it's a good question. Stephen BJ, I'm going to say your last name wrong, and I'm going to apologize right now. Madre, I butchered it. I'm done. All right, let's get the question. I've recently seen several videos of people flushing hens off of nests. Will that hen most likely abandon that nest?
Stephen, I am disappointed in you that you would even ask me that after working for me for that long.
Uh-oh.
So this question's actually popped up a few times here. People asking what the general question is, what's the impact of disturbance on nest sites, human disturbance? Mm-hmm. If somebody is out there videoing a nest and then flushing a bird off the nest, they've been to that nest more than once. Because most people are walking around with a cell phone out in front of them. Typically, yeah, you're going to see some nest abandonment, but it depends on how far into the incubation cycle that bird is. So if she's in, say, the first week, then the likelihood of her abandoning that nest due to an event where a hunter or somebody walking through the woods just happens to bump up into her is probably high. But if she's in the last week of incubation, it's pretty low. So they get a lot more resilient to being disturbed by little nuisance type things the later that they get into incubation. That said, repeated disturbance generally is a bad thing. But, I mean, I've seen some birds that walk next to roads that have highways going back and forth by them that don't ever seem to move them up. So at the end of the day, happen to come across a turkey nest, you should not disturb it, just as a general rule.
Yeah, and I would
add, step away from the nest.
I get this question a lot on social media. Please, please do not go put a camera.
Oh, no.
Nest. I understand that you want to get documentation of what's going on. Rarely does that ever end well. When we put cameras on nests, and I've had, in fact, somebody lit me up on Instagram the other day about this, sent me a message and said, well, I'm aware that you've done some camera work at nest. What's the difference? The difference is that we are tracking these birds. We wait until they're on a recess when they're not at the clutch because we know. Then we go put the camera out. Flushing a bird off the nest and then putting a camera there, that's a double whammy. Not only are you flushing the bird off through no intentions of your own, but but then you're spending the time, or more importantly, revisiting the site to put the camera there, that you're almost, you're just asking for that nest to fail. So I beg people, if you flush a bird off the nest, if you want to take a quick picture, fine, take a picture and then get out of there. Get out of there. Don't disturb the vegetation. Don't leave your scent. Don't hang around. Get out and don't put a camera there. Maybe she'll come back and give it a go. But a lot of times they don't. Like Brett said early, if they're early in the incubation, they just, a lot of times they quit. And those first clutches, and that's, this is us turkey hunting. If you're bumping a nest in April, that's a first clutch. Man, that is the money in our populations. We got to have those nests. So try to do everything in your power not to compromise it, and repeatedly visiting it and putting cameras up, that's not the way to do it.
Yeah, I had I will put a plug in here, and I don't know if Justin is watching. I do know that he told my friend Jason that this would be a lot more fun if I was actually drinking during it, as opposed to drinking the water I'm drinking now. But I had a student named Justin Drivalis, who's with Texas Parks and Wildlife now, actually did a study on it, where he set up a whole bunch of experimental nest sites and then disturbed them with cameras and one trip back or multiple trip backs. And basically every single visit that you make to one of those nest sites increases the chance of that nest failing. So Mike is absolutely right. We're not going to tell anybody their business, but if you flush a nest, take a picture, back off, and save it for another day and hope that it makes 12 pulls instead of a picture.
Yep.
All right. Very good. Very good. Very good. All right. Let me ask you one more thing about hens and poults as we kind of get near the end here of hitting on what we want to talk about. But did these hens, like, guide the poults around? I mean, in that picture even, it looks like the poults were in advance of the hen. Probably something good for folks to know.
Yeah, the poults run. Basically, what happens is the hen kind of directs the poults to a spot or to areas. And then once they get to areas where they're foraging, which they do most of the day, the poults kind of guide the action, and the hen is kind of a shepherd. And what causes poults to stay in the same place is encounter rates. So the more encounters they have with bugs, the longer they're going to dilly-dally around and forage, which is a good thing. When they stop encountering things, they're going to truck it. And at that point, the hen is then going to move that brood to somewhere else. Now, this starts to go out the window, and you know this if you watched older broods. When you get a brood that's like 40 days old, it's a free-for-all. I mean, they do whatever, just like damn kids, you know. Just insolent little
wah, 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 wah.
Exactly. You know, it's like you don't listen to anything. You just go walking off and doing whatever it is you want to do. As they get older, the poults really run the show. But initially, it's kind of, hey, I'm going to get you to a spot. You forage, and then when it's time to move, we'll move. Meanwhile, I'll stand here and try to keep everything that's in the woods from eating you.
Some evidence, and I'll let you talk of this because this is coming out of your shop, but on birds actually going back to the same spots that were productive for a couple of days.
Yeah. What we're seeing is these broods will revisit places, and meaning they'll trace back on themselves. So you kind of imagine you're walking through the woods and you encounter a lot of stuff, and your encounter rate goes down, so you leave. Well, these birds kind of wired to remember that. And some of the observational work that has been shown, Bill Healy's work scientifically kind of showed this. Joe Hutto's work, observational, more popular type stuff, showed the same thing. Although in that case, he was kind of leading those broods at times, but as they aged, they kind of did their own thing, which he wrote at length about. We're seeing that with our telemetry data. They're doing the same thing. They revisit these places that are are better quality. Now what we're going to try to figure out is what's there. Like, what is it about these places they revisit so much that's different from the other parts of the landscape? Because to me, if you got a brood that's revisiting a place, that only means two things: lots of forage and predation. No predation, right? They feel safe and they can eat a lot. If we can identify what's there and what, more importantly, what caused that situation to be there, that could provide some really, really important habitat management information.
Yeah.
Good stuff, guys. We had a question earlier from, if Pete can find it, I'm going to put him on the mark here, from Michael Lee. Can a Jake breed a hen? Specifically, if an area only has one or two toms and both are harvested or shot early in the season, can a Jake continue the breeding cycle?
So let's back up a little bit, because this is a question that I get a lot and Mike gets a lot. And there tends to be some misconceptions that exist on this. So the main question comes in is, can a juvenile male who was born last year successfully breed and impregnate a female? The obvious answer is yes, but the rate at which it occurs is minuscule. There was some work done in the 60s and 70s and some more recent work done in the 90s that have looked at things like spermatogenesis and are the juvenile males, creating viable sperm. And people read numbers in the literature of 28% or 30% or 6%, and they assume that that means that those males are actually contributing. You can effectively assume that for all of the reproductive events and most of the kind of second, your juvenile males aren't even in the hierarchy that the females are breeding with. Now, there's always going to be exceptions to the rule, and I'm not going to go too far out on this limb, but as a general rule, the answer is no. Most of them haven't undergone spermatogenesis. They're not producing viable sperm. Of the ones that have undergone it and are producing viable sperm, they're not likely of social rank to copulate with females. Now, what I'll get, typically people say, well, I saw a Jake mounting on a female, a Jenny, in March. Well, yeah, but he's probably not getting the job done because they're probably not to the point where he is reproductively viable. Females tend to be a little bit more physiologically advanced than the juvenile males are. And at the time that the females are in these, we kind of talked about it earlier, these kind of reproductive flocks, juvenile males aren't in those flocks. They're the ones that come in and try and beat up on the adult males, but you don't suddenly see all the juvenile or all the females running around with those Jake flocks. The adult females kind of move off at the time. So it probably doesn't happen very often. I've got that question a lot lately. It's not a more intelligent way to say it. Now I think about it is that juvenile male breeding is not a driver of reproduction. I think that's really, really clear way to put it.
Yep. And I just want to point out to Philip Ford, who asked this, pointed out in this question about I'm fussing at my students and he's having traumatic flashbacks. There's a difference between, and I'm pointing now, there's a difference between fussing and passion, right? I think it's passion. Philip, it's fussing, but it's not. Just don't go put a camera in a nest. But to Brett's point, the bottom line is research years ago has shown this. There are two conflicting studies on this. One earlier study basically said that there was a fairly significant portion of Jakes that could fertilize clutches. What you don't see in the small print is that study excluded a very large sample of birds from their sample because they couldn't locate testes.
Or vas deferens.
Right. So they couldn't, they just, we excluded those birds. So more recent research out of Texas has shown that there is a very, we're talking less than 5% of your Jakes can even produce enough viable sperm to consider fertilizing a clutch. Now, that's not even, that's just to possibly do it. Not do it, possibly do it. So if you factor in that, in addition to this notion that what they also showed is that the quality of those, the viability of those sperm declined, that you'd have to have a super Jake. There, I mean, he'd have to literally be a super Jake And they don't, that's not out there. The bottom line is jakes are not producing enough viable sperm in sufficient volume to fertilize clutches at any rate. Those are toms that are doing that. And the other thing that's important to consider is that not all toms are breeders. There's solid evidence showing that the presence of one tom against another tom can cause one tom to not produce sperm, enough sperm. So there, the whole jake question, and we get it a lot, the whole jake question is, the bottom line is jakes are not breeders. They're just not.
There's a neat little anecdote for all the turkey hunters out there. And I know, Mike, I think Sarah's collecting information, is testes color. Typically, males, if you take out their testes after you've harvested them legally and everything, you pull out their testes, if their testes are white, then they are likely producing viable sperm. That's kind of was one of the things that this Texas study had shown. But if their testes are off-white, off-color, dark, and certain portions are black, then they haven't actually undergone spermatogenesis, and they're not producing viable sperm. So if you're just interested, it's a little anecdotal thing. You can go in, and I think Sarah's the one doing that, right?
Yeah.
So, you can go in and just look for yourself. So, and that is exactly right, Mark.
Hey, I spent the morning with
Good
Mark.
Good comment, man. Great comment. Yeah. I like that. Hey, we're going to end with a little bit of fun here before we get into a next step, so to speak. But I have a couple of pictures to show you, and it's from a board member, NWTF board member out of Idaho, and harvested a bird. It's a hen. Pete, if you could bring up those pics, it'd be awesome. It's a bearded hen, and we get a ton of questions every year about bearded hens and what they look like. But look at this bearded hen and look at her head real quick, guys. If you take a look at it, I mean, you can look, and at first look, if you didn't know, you would probably think this was a gobbler. All right. We went black. I hope we didn't blank him out. We're back again. Got a nice beard on this bird. Pete, show us the second pic. We got a picture of the leg as well, the foot. There we go. You know, the middle toe's much longer. No spur on this bird. Very lightweight bird, your typical hen characteristics. We get a lot of calls about and questions about bearded hens every year. And just curious, you know, what do we think are the number of, how many bearded hens do we have out there in the population, guys?
We see about, at least captured birds, we see anywhere from 5 to 8, 9% that are bearded. I think it's more common than people believe because some of these beards can be almost impossible to find. Yeah. Like even when you catch the bird, you start, you know, you just happen to, I remember many years ago, I just happened to glance at a bird that one of my technicians was holding. And I was like, wait a minute, she's got a beard. Talking just a few strands. Yeah. It's not uncommon to have bearded hens. The bottom line is the papilla that grow from which the beard grows, they all have it. So some just happen to grow a beard out of that, like all toms do, or most toms do. And it just so happens that certain hens also grow beards out of that same papilla that's on the chest. So it's not uncommon.
Brian Wakeling out there in Arizona years ago found like 15%, didn't he, in an unpublished study he was doing out there, if I remember right?
Yeah.
No, it's not uncommon to have bearded hens. You know?
Yeah.
It's like every other hen.
Yeah, they act. I mean, we've caught a lot of bearded hens. We put a lot of GPS tags on bearded hens. They nest, they brood, they have successful clutches. They act like turkeys. They do the exact same thing that their non-bearded brethren do.
Well, I thought I'd bring that up just as kind of a side. I know we've had some questions from within about bearded hens, et cetera, and I think it's good for sure. Do you feel that bearded hens are the boss hen out there?
No,
there's no evidence to suggest that they're at the top of their pecking order because they have a beard. Again, it's
yeah,
the structure from which that beard grows, they all have it. It's just that some express it and most don't.
Well, appreciate you answering those questions and many of the other questions out there. I know there's some that we did not hit on today. And let me reiterate real quick. We have some of our key staff out there. Once again, we have three our awesome biologists. More than that, I know we have other staff from across the nation that's been on and off. But Cully McCurdy, Ricky Lackey, and Annie Farrell are going to be there trying to help answer some of the questions we may have missed. I know we'll be on as well, looking on afterward to try to hit on any of the questions. We appreciate everyone being here. Once again, we appreciate the support. Thank you for the support to the NWTF. We need your help right now more than ever. So I'm going to plug that in real quick. Anything you can do to provide some support right now, we appreciate it. We want to continue doing these kind of series. We want to continue the conservation work. We want to continue the mission of making sure that we have wild turkeys for the future generations. We are the conservation organization, and we will continue to manage uplands better than anyone out there. That's how I feel about it. And with the help of folks like these guys here, we can make great management decisions to get us there. So I want to thank everyone for being here one more time. I do want to give y'all a quick teaser. Don't leave yet. Quick teaser about what's coming up. Because you cats are going to want to know what we're going to do in the upcoming weeks. All right. Next week, we're going to address something that everyone's hungry to know about: wild turkey decline. Yeah, I said it. Wild turkey decline. Make sure you're here. Tell your friends about it, et cetera. It's going to be a great discussion. And then the week after, we're going to hit on something else as these turkey seasons are hammering through, et cetera. We're going to address seasons and harvest impacts. One more time, seasons and harvest impacts. Those are going to be the next two big episodes. So make sure as we get this information out, share it with your friends, tell them about it. There's a ton of people out there that are asking us questions throughout all the states. I know they want more information here. So please share the good word, and we're going to come back. We're going to do this next week. Same place, same time, drinks at hand, and we're going to have a good time with it. Bring your questions, comments. We appreciate having you. I hope y'all have a blessed week. Do that responsible recreation, please, for me and for others. Take care of yourselves. See y'all.